So I want to ask this question and then answer this question. Does the expression of love change with Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia? Does the expression of love with the five love languages change with Alzheimer's and other dementias? And the answer is yes, it does. So what are some observations that we've made about people with Alzheimer's? And for the most part, this is true of anyone who's in middle or late stage dementia. As the disease progresses and the person becomes more cognitively impaired, so their thinking abilities are affected, their ability to express love diminishes. So this is sort of important. Principle number one is, as the person's journey progresses over time with Alzheimer's or other forms of dementia, they become more and more unable to express their love. But, and this is really, really important, the ability for of that person to feel loved is preserved into the latest stage of the disease, and I would contend up until the last moment of their last breath. The ability to feel loved is preserved late in the disease all the way to the end. So what changes over time is primarily emotional expression or the ability to express emotion. What doesn't change is the ability to feel loved. To have emotion shared with them. It's just we're used to, in a relationship not affected by dementia, we're used to the emotional reciprocity, right? The giving and the feeling back and forth, the exchange of emotion and feeling in relationship. But it becomes lopsided in a relationship affected by dementia. And as Anna said to you earlier, that the and I'm just using different words to say the same thing, that the depth and the breadth of the love connection lies almost entirely in the hands of the care partner. I had never seen that YouTube segment that Anna had shown called She Knows, but it will definitely be integrated into my talks. That was absolutely beautiful. And it's an example of how, as the daughter connected with her mother over that couple of minutes of the YouTube segment, it was not an intellectual connection of, oh, mom, you know, think of all the wonderful memories that we've shared over the years. It was just, you know, what did the mom keep saying back to the daughter is, you know, I love you. And the daughter saying to the mom, I love you. It was all about the emotion. And this is really what I want to share is that very often when we're caught in a situation that we don't know how to handle, in a person living with dementia, we resort to a cognitive solution. But what we need to do is resort to an emotional connection. So I'm going to give you an example of this. I was doing a seminar about a month ago, and I got a question from a physical therapist who had a client in the senior community that he worked at, he would go and get her for physical therapy. They would do therapy, and then he would wheel her back to her room. And every time he wheeled her back to her room, she would say, I can't wait to get back to my room because my mother's going to be there and I'm going to be able to talk to my mother again. I'm going to converse with my mother. Well, this woman was herself in her 90s, and her mother had died 30 years before. And I find that family members, when they have a loved one with dementia and that loved one is actually conversing with, say, their mother or their father who has long been deceased, or they'll talk about their mother or father as if they were in the present, that the response of the family member and the response of this physical therapist was the same thing. It was to correct them. So that's what I mean by a cognitive solution. Oh, mom, your mother died 30 years ago. You can't talk to your mother. But in fact, what that person is doing is they're trying to attach by calling out or talking to their deceased parent. They're trying to just attach to their most familiar attachment figure in their life. And so it's very common for people living with dementia to talk to their attachment figures, usually their parents, usually their mother. And you can't explain it away cognitively. So my advice to this physical therapist was, you know, rather than correcting this woman and telling her that her mother had died 30 years ago and that she wasn't going to be able to talk to her mother, take the person back to her room and make an emotional connection. So he said, well, how do I do that? So here's how you would make the emotional connection. He'd wheel her back to her room, and then he would sit down in a chair and he'd pull a chair up to her. And maybe he would hold her hand if she felt comfortable with that, but he could at least pull close. And he could say to her, he could acknowledge that she is thinking about her mother. Oh, well, tell me, what was your mother's name? Tell me your favorite memory about your mother. Tell me what you love the most about your mother. Tell me something about your mother. Tell me a story about your mother that would make me laugh. In other words, he's connecting her. He's helping her connect to the memory, the loving memory of her mother. And that's an emotional connection. It's not a cognitive connection. It's an emotional connection. And I say this over and over in therapy to clients and in groups, to family care partners. And I say this to professional care partners. Keep it on and keep the connection emotional. So one of you had asked the question of Anna, you know, my loved one is in residential care and the community shut down by COVID. How do I connect to them? So in that situation, she mentioned, you know, using like FaceTime or using, you know, some audio. There's all these different ways, Zoom, all these ways you can audio visually connect. Now, it's true, you can't be there to hold your loved one's hand, but there can be a caregiver at the residential care setting who can hold the hand and facilitate you talking to your parent who's there. And so, you know, these are strange times we're in. I talk about in my other book that I'll mention at the end, and we talk about in Keeping Love Alive, the importance of a facilitator. And right now, because you can't physically be there, you need a facilitator. You need someone to, you know, do FaceTime or Zoom. And then you can actually use a facilitator to help you bond with the other love languages. So I want to show you a few examples of how our family connected with Rebecca during her journey with Alzheimer's disease. This is Paul when he was about 3 years old. He's the 10-year-old. And Paul is a quality time kid. He always has been. And here you can see him looking at Rebecca. And he would jump up. So Rebecca loved to color. She couldn't color very well. It didn't really matter. She enjoyed it. In fact, you can see Paul at age 3 is able to color much better than Rebecca, who just is making red blotches on the lower left-hand corner of that piece of paper. But look at his eye contact with her. He is making a connection with her that is making her feel settled and to feel loved. And, you know, this is just a quality time, the natural characteristic of this 3-year-old boy. This is my youngest daughter, Carrie, sharing a cup of coffee with Rebecca. and you can see they're holding hands. Now, Rebecca, as part of her journey with Alzheimer's disease, became very touch averse. Now, as I said to you, she and I were lovey-dovey, right? Holding hands, arm in arm. You know, we always sat together on the couch and held hands, and, you know, we'd even lock our arms together. She became very touch averse once she was in the middle stage of her Alzheimer's disease. But by connecting with her with a cup of coffee, you can see here that she's letting Carrie hold her hands, even though she doesn't recognize Carrie as her daughter. Here's Rebecca and I on the couch. Every evening after supper, we would sit on the couch. I would put on the soundtrack, the music video of the soundtrack of Sound of Music. It's Rebecca's favorite movie. And she would sit there and she would listen to the music, and it would calm her enough that you can see I'm able to lay my head on her shoulder and touch her. It was really the only time in a day when we could share physical contact. And so, you know, this is the nature of how intimacy changes in a relationship, but how you can use these five love languages here: words of affirmation, quality time, and physical touch to communicate emotional love. Now, Anna mentioned before that people living with dementia, they like to sort of compulsively wrap things up, sort the mail, pull tissues out of a box. For Rebecca, her compulsive behavior was breaking sticks into little pieces. And here is one of her caregivers, Letisa. So Letisa, as an act of service to Rebecca, would come to work early every day. She'd walk around our yard and our neighbor's yard. She'd pick up a big recycling bin full of sticks. And then she and Rebecca would go out and they would, quote, do sticks. And this was very settling for Rebecca to do, especially when she was sundowning and became agitated. We would gather that bucket of sticks up and take her out to the recycling bin, and she would stand there. You can see she's got her gait belt on, and you don't see it, but Letisa is hanging on to her because at this point she was pretty unsteady on her feet. And she would take those twigs and she would break them into about 1-inch pieces. And she would do it twig after twig after twig. This is a woman who has a master's degree in speech pathology with an IQ of 150. But it was calming to her. It was something that she could do successfully, and she could do it hours on end. And so we let her do that. And Letisa facilitated that with an act of service. Rebecca was not a materialistic person, but she sure did love the gift of an ice cream cone. And this was something that also could really calm her when she was agitated, was just ice cream. She loved ice cream. And that or coffee were things that we could share with her. And then this is my middle daughter, Leah, who's a singer and a songwriter. This was something that Rebecca was really calmed by, was hearing Leah play guitar and sing to her. One time, Rebecca had a particularly agitated evening. She was sundowning, and it kept going on and on and on. It lasted, you know, all the way to bedtime, and we put her in bed and put the guardrails up on the hospital bed, and she was so agitated, she was literally climbing the walls with her feet. So Leah went in and she started playing her guitar and singing, and pretty soon the feet came off the wall, and then Rebecca was still sort of kicking her covers, and we made and, you know, retucked her in half a dozen times, and pretty soon she sort of let us keep the covers on her. And then she finally started getting drowsy, and she looked at Rebecca. Rebecca looked at Leah, and she said to Leah, "You know, I have a daughter who plays guitar and sings just like you." And it was one of those bittersweet things. It was so sweet, and yet it was a reminder of her not knowing, not recognizing us as her family anymore. So this is an example of how you can use the five love languages. And in a sense, this is what compelled writing the book, is to say that you can use these five love languages. They're very easy to remember. And you can sort of go down the list and say, okay, can I spend some time with him or her? Maybe that's a way to communicate love. Maybe it's a hug or holding their hand, physical touch. Maybe it's some calming or soothing or affirming words. Or maybe I can do something for them, an act of service, like rubbing their feet or rubbing their back, or maybe singing a favorite hymn to them or a song. Or it could be a gift, you know, like a cookie or a piece of candy. But you can sort of go down that list and say, you know, what can I use to connect with him or her in this moment, to make them feel loved? So that's the five love languages as a toolkit. So I want to switch gears and talk about intimacy. And I'm going to share with you as a way of doing this, three stories of clients that I've counseled in the memory counseling program who were challenged in different ways with intimacy in their relationship. Here they are. So I've changed their names, and these are just, these are not their actual pictures. But they look like the couple, and the stories are absolutely true stories. So Pamela and Clyde, their relationship was affected by Clyde, who had Alzheimer's disease, by his delusion of infidelity. So I'm going to tell you this story in some detail in the next set of slides. The next story is the story of Ren and Ritsuko, a Japanese couple who came into my office. Ritsuko, the wife, had very early stage Alzheimer's disease, but they came into the office because they had just grown apart, grown distant from one another. And then there was Maxine and Malcolm. Maxine had dementia as well, and they had been married for many years. They were still sexually active into their 70s, and when they were having an intimate moment together, Maxine had kind of a similar moment that Rebecca had with me. She didn't recognize Malcolm anymore, but it happened in the bedroom, and she had a very sort of dramatic reaction to that. So I'm going to tell you each of these stories in a bit more detail, but I want to first just say that there are many challenges to love and to intimacy in a couple's relationship that's affected by Alzheimer's disease or really any form of dementia. So as Anna mentioned, you know, we believe now that some of the very earliest changes that happen in people who develop dementia are personality changes. She gave a very thoughtful explanation of what apathy is. But you know, there can be apathy in the love relationship. There can be a complete loss of sex drive. And that can be really damaging for a couple. People, as people get older, and as our sex hormones, our testosterone, estrogen, progesterone, as these levels decrease in the blood, our sex drive decreases as well, our libido or our nature. And so this can affect the relationship. But personality changes can affect the relationship in the opposite way. This is particularly true in people who are living with the behavior variant of frontotemporal dementia. So frontotemporal dementia is not so much about memory loss, though it can happen especially later on. It's more about changes in behavior. and the person can become disinhibited. They can do and say things that they normally wouldn't do. And so a person who has frontotemporal dementia can become hypersexual. In other words, their sex drive can go into overdrive, and they can want to have sex frequently. I had a client, a counseling client last fall, and where this was the situation, and the husband was the one who had the frontotemporal dementia. He wanted to have sex with his wife like 10 times a day. And she just came in and she was sort of worn out and worn down by what was happening. So it can be the other way too. Memory loss. So you've heard the stories of mistaken or forgotten identity, and that can really affect a relationship if the person doesn't know their mate anymore. Or the person can forget the routine of foreplay and sex. So most couples have kind of their routine that they, their routine of foreplay before they have intercourse, or maybe just enjoy touching one another or being intimate with one another without necessarily having intercourse. But, you know, we all have our likes and our dislikes in the bedroom. And if you've forgotten those, that can affect the relationship. Poor hygiene. Hygiene does change as the person progresses through their dementia, and poor hygiene can be a real challenge for enjoying intimacy. Hypersensitivity to touch, meaning people with dementia, they can become overly sensitive to any of the five senses, but particularly touch and noise. Sound. And so things that normally would have felt good, or music maybe that was soothing, no longer feels good or sounds good. And then there's this delusion of infidelity. So Anna mentioned that people with dementia can have delusions about maybe being things being stolen from them. That's a common delusion. That I think the next most common delusion is the delusion of infidelity. And that's what happened in this story of Pamela and Clyde. So let me share their story with you, because this delusion of infidelity is a common one. And so I had been seeing Pamela, who is the spouse of 61 years to Clyde. And he had early stage Alzheimer's disease. And he was having a lot of delusions. He was having delusions that she and the kids were stealing money from him. And he had made references to delusions of infidelity, but it came to a head when they were at the grocery store. So imagine they're walking down the grocery store aisle, and a man passes them who is about Clyde's age. And so now this man has passed them, he's turned the corner, and he's already in the next aisle. And Clyde says to Pamela, "Who is that man that just walked by?" And she says, "I don't know, I've never seen him before." And he says, "It sure looked like you knew him to me." And she says, "Why, he is a perfect stranger." And then Clyde loses it, and he screams out, "You're sleeping with him, aren't you? You blank." And he called her a name that she absolutely never imagined he would call her. And she was devastated. And of course, she reacted very defensively. And she said, "Why, of course not. How dare you?" And I'll never forget walking in, and she was sitting in my office, and I came in the room, and I think I had one foot in the door, and I could hear her crying already. You know, they had had a long relationship. They had been faithful to one another, and this accusation absolutely broke her. And so, so what I talked with Pamela about was a strategy that I call the AAR strategy: acknowledge, affirm, and redirect. And this is a strategy that can be used in almost any situation that you encounter with a loved one, or if you're a healthcare professional and a person living with dementia, no matter what the situation is. I'm not saying it always works, but it's a situation that you can almost always use. And it's a strategy that I teach around behavioral challenges, but the root of the strategy is in attachment and reconnecting people to reduce separation distress-related behaviors. So in this moment, let's empathize with Clyde and think, what's going on with him? Why does he accuse Pamela of cheating on him? Well, maybe in that moment he doesn't recognize her as his wife, even though they've been married for 60 years. Maybe he sees this guy and, you know, he sort of looks at Pamela and he thinks, oh, maybe something's going on between them. It isn't a rational thought. There's no factual basis, but that's what a delusion is. A delusion is when you believe something to be true that isn't true, where there's evidence to the contrary. And that's the problem with her sort of responding to him and denying the accusation, is that's a cognitive response. And so, as I said earlier, you want to stay in the moment emotionally and not deal with it cognitively. So I suggested this strategy to Pamela. So first of all, you'll find that most people living with dementia who become agitated, they're up pacing and walking. It can happen while they're sitting. It can happen while they're in bed. But most people who become agitated or have really any sort of negative emotional expression, they're going to be up, walking, pacing, moving, you know, repetitively vocalizing. They're going to have too much behavior, if you will. So the first thing to do is you want to calm that person. And so if we had more time, I would do a whole segment now on mindfulness. Debbie gave you a little mindfulness 101 exercise earlier. So the first thing that Pamela could do is to say to Clyde, to first acknowledge what he said. Because what we tend to do when we don't know what to say is we just ignore it. And we kind of hope it's going to go away, or we try and respond cognitively. But you want to acknowledge that person's behavior. So she's going to acknowledge to Clyde and say, Clyde, did you think that I knew that man? Or Clyde, I don't know that man. Clyde, that man, I've never seen him before. She's going to acknowledge what he has said. Maybe she would just say, Clyde, you look really upset. Clyde, you seem angry. That would be even a more emotionally focused kind of response. And then you're going to try and sort of bring some calm to the situation. So she could say, honey, let's go sit in those chairs that are at the front of the store. So then they walk to the front of the store and they sit down in the chair. And maybe she holds his hand or she rests her hand on his arm. Let's take a few deep breaths in. Golly, it's been kind of a hard day already, hasn't it? And so then she's acknowledged that he's upset. So you don't want to sort of ignore the situation and pretend it hasn't happened. People will often ask me, what do you do if somebody is having a hallucination? They're seeing things or hearing things that aren't there. And so it doesn't do any good to say to the person, well, I know you say you're hearing children singing, but there's no children there, or I don't hear any children's voices. It's a very cognitive response. For that person, hearing or seeing those children singing is as real to them as if they were really standing there and singing in front of them. And so you can respond, you can acknowledge, oh, do you hear children singing again? Or, oh, do you see the children again? Let's go sit down and listen to them. So that's the acknowledge part of this, is joining the person. Because if you believe that the root of the challenging situation or that is them feeling unattached and unloved, the acknowledgement is the first step in reattachment.